Hey guys, Dr. Childs here. Today I have with me Dr. Eric Osansky. Dr. Eric Osansky is a chiropractor, clinical nutritionist, a certified functional medicine practitioner, and author of the book Natural Treatment Solutions for Hyperthyroidism and Graves' Disease. Dr. Osansky was personally diagnosed with Graves' disease and has been in remission through the use of natural therapies for quite some time. His focus is now on helping people with hyperthyroidism do everything that they can to avoid radioactive iodine ablation and thyroid surgery. So Dr. Osansky, welcome to the show.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Dr. Childs. Appreciate it. Look forward to sharing some great information with your listeners.
Absolutely. I think we're going to have a good time here. I don't know if this is the same as you, but maybe not for you, but I get accused a lot of not talking enough about hyperthyroidism. So there's this group of patients who have hyperthyroidism who I think get a little bit neglected, right? Because a lot of people, more people, if we're talking statistics, have hypothyroidism than they do hyperthyroidism. So I tend to focus more on the hypo group. But for those people who have hyperthyroidism, Graves' disease, thyroidectomy, RAI, this one is for you. And so we're really grateful to have Dr. Osansky with us today. Doc, I want you to, if you could, just maybe introduce yourself to the listeners here. Tell us a little bit about your own personal story, because I know you've had a personal history with Graves' disease. So maybe you could just dive in there and kind of explain what happened to you briefly, and then how that kind of informs what you're doing now with your patients.
Sure. So back in 2008, I was dieting, detoxifying, and in my case, I was losing a lot of weight. A little bit, we'll talk about weight gain and hyperthyroidism, but you know, a number of people also lose weight, and that was me. I lost 42 pounds when I was dealing with Graves' disease, but at the time, I didn't know it was hyperthyroidism until one day I just checked my resting heart rate. Actually, what happened, I checked my blood pressure, which also measured my heart rate, and the blood pressure was fine, but the resting heart rate was elevated. And so I wasn't sure what was up. So the next few days, I just continued to check my heart rate, and it continued to be, you know, initially like 90, but it would fluctuate between 90 and sometimes going over 100. Mm-hmm. And so I, you know, was thinking maybe hyperthyroidism, but again, I didn't have experience at the time working with other patients. So mm-hmm. I saw a primary care doctor, and he did some blood tests, and sure enough, I had hyperthyroidism. And eventually saw an endocrinologist, and you know, she tested antibodies and was diagnosed with Graves' disease. And even though I didn't have experience at the time with Graves' disease or you know, hyperthyroidism, I knew I was going to take a natural approach just because I would attend, as part of my continuing education credits, I would attend nutritional seminars, and I attended a few functional endocrinology conferences. So I knew there was a natural approach for thyroid conditions. That, as you mentioned, hypothyroidism more common. So they spoke mm-hmm. more about hypothyroidism, but they also spoke about hyperthyroidism a little bit.
Right.
And so long story short, I took a natural approach for hyperthyroidism. And we could talk more about that if you'd like. But mm-hmm. And since 2009, I've been in remission. And, you know, just it's you know, been a challenge been a challenge maintaining my health. It's always, you know, it's always a work in progress. You mm-hmm. know, once you get into the routine, you know, it's not too bad. And again, we could talk more about this, but, you know, getting back to 2009, I realized that there's a lot of people with both hyperthyroidism, hypothyroidism. So I started working with people with both hypo and hyper, Graves, Hashimoto's. And just over the years, even though I've seen both hyper and hypo patients, with hyperthyroidism tend to resonate with me more just because that's my personal story.
Sure.
So as you mentioned, I wrote a book on hyperthyroidism. Mm-hmm. I actually wrote a book on Hashimoto's as well as in 2018. But just over the last couple of years, I've made more of a shift to hyperthyroidism, even though I still see some patients with Hashimoto's. Mm-hmm. But yeah, there's a lot more patients with a lot more people with hypothyroidism, there's still a lot out there with hyperthyroidism, Graves' disease, toxic multinodular goiter, and mm-hmm. that in a nutshell is my story.
That's awesome. I appreciate you sharing that. And actually, I want to go back to one point that you mentioned. So for those listening as well, maybe you could talk about this a little bit, but you kind of said maybe it's been a struggle, and that probably wasn't the right word that you wanted to use there. But I do think that's actually pretty important, because a lot of patients, I think, know that there is this opportunity to naturally treat their conditions, right? And I think people know that it exists and know that they can do it. But I think maybe what they kind of fail to understand is that it is a process. You know, getting going from a state of autoimmunity to a state of remission. Once you get there, you know, that's a feat unto itself. However, it's going to take some iteration and changes to your diet and therapy over the long term to stay that way. You know, and you're always going to have, at least in my experience, kind of have a propensity to go back to that autoimmune state. Maybe, you know, if you're not careful, if you have too much stress, if you have these factors and triggers, you might see your antibodies start to creep up and whatnot. So I do think that's a really important point. So for those people who are listening to us, to this discussion we're going to have, you know, if you are able to get yourself into remission, continuing education, continue to learn and figure out what's going on in your body is still very important. You know, is that kind of true? Does that ring true to you in your personal experience?
Oh, I agree. When I was actually looking to get into remission, that was very challenging. Mm-hmm. Both mentally it was challenging, emotionally it was challenging. And then, as you mentioned, making the dietary changes, you know, and then since then, I don't want to use this word struggle to stay in remission, but, you know, I still have to try to eat well most of the time. Nobody's going to be perfect 100% of the time, but most of the time eat well and manage my stress, which was a big factor, I think, in my Graves' disease condition, mm-hmm. and, you know, get proper sleep. So a lot of the basics and a lot of it becomes routine. So yeah, without question, when you're trying to get into remission, it's definitely not a quick and easy process. And even when you're trying to maintain a state of wellness, I can't say it's easy, but it's easier, I guess, compared to when trying to achieve that state of remission.
For sure. And I would agree with that. I think, yeah, it's very difficult to get to that point, but then, you know, it becomes a little easier, but still something you have to pay attention to maintain it. And so that really kind of brings me into the next topic. So we can kind of tie in your own personal history of these natural treatments, because I really want to hear more about them. So as a backdrop, I'm going to explain something and then to the listeners, because I know you already know this, Dr. Osansky, but I'm going to explain this to them and then we can kind of pick where we're going to be talking about here. So when I talk a lot about Graves' disease, there's a lot of confusion among thyroid patients, right? Because we have people who have maybe just been initially diagnosed with Graves' disease who have a certain set of symptoms. Then we have people who have been diagnosed and are now taking anti-thyroid medication who have a different set of symptoms because that treatment interferes with thyroid function. And then, heaven forbid this occurs, but it does occur, if this area fails with the anti-thyroid medication and the natural treatments, then you move on to thyroid surgery or radioactive iodine ablation. And that comes with a whole new set of problems. So we kind of have three groups, kind of three areas here. Now, what I want to do is kind of extract out the middle one here. And this includes people who have been recently diagnosed and who are using anti-thyroid medication. And the reason I want to focus on them is because we have the opportunity through treatments to potentially prevent the progression to thyroid removal and radioactive iodine ablation. And I think that's really the key here. So what I want to do is talk about natural treatments. And again, I'm just giving the backdrop for those people listening, because I know you know this, Dr. Osansky, but let's talk a little bit about the natural treatments that people can do to try and prevent that radioactive iodine and thyroid surgery. So you talked a little bit about yourself. You talked that you use some natural therapy. So maybe what you can do is intertwine what you use and kind of how you look at patients when it comes to natural therapies during this time. So if you kind of expand your philosophy on that area.
Sure. So I also want to add that while a lot of my patients take anti-thyroid medication, not everybody. So I chose to take an herb, bugleweed, which I'm sure you're familiar with. And bugleweed, it doesn't work in everybody. There's, you know, you just, everything comes down to risk versus benefits, and anti-thyroid medication without question is more effective, but it also comes with greater side effects.
Right.
So there are some people that just choose not to start the anti-thyroid medication and take the bugleweed, or someone might experience side effects and switch to the bugleweed. I never tell someone to stop taking the medication and to take the bugleweed, but bugleweed, from a symptom management option, bugleweed is one option that could help lower thyroid hormone levels. And I also took motherwort, which I kind of relate it to a natural beta blocker. It's not directly affecting the thyroid, but can help with palpitations. So when I was taking a bugleweed, it definitely helped with my resting heart rate, because I would monitor it on a daily basis, but I was still having some palpitations, eventually introduced motherwort. But then as far as additional supplements to try to correct triggers, underlying imbalances, so there are some general supplements I recommend. And then, you know, I do typically recommend certain tests, and then other supplements are based on the test results. So for example, some general supplement recommendations I might give include omega-3 fatty acids. So for example, a fish oil, and people could even test, they could do like an omega-3 index to see if they're deficient, which many people are, especially if they're not supplementing or if they're not eating fish regularly. And so so that's one supplement which could greatly help with inflammation. Probiotic, when we think about probiotics, a lot of people think about gut health, which is true, but it also modulates the immune system. And vitamin D. So vitamin D, I definitely want to test for, which is an easy test, as you know, right. Doing like a 25 hydroxy vitamin D. And a lot of people are deficient in vitamin D. And some people are within a lab range, but they're not within an optimal range.
Sure.
So vitamin D, selenium, and there's a number of research studies when it comes to thyroid health, thyroid autoimmunity, even thyroid eye disease, the benefits of selenium. And you know, but then again, as I mentioned, I like to do testing too. So like when I was diagnosed with Graves, I had, and one of the tests I did was an adrenal saliva test. And at the time I was in denial because I didn't think stress, I knew stress was a factor, but honestly, I thought I was good at handling the stress. So yeah. I honestly didn't expect the adrenal testing to look as bad as it did. And so, you know, when it comes to supporting adrenals, before we talk about supplements, of course, diet and lifestyle are important. So, you know, you want to eat well, whole healthy foods. You want to block out time for stress management, try to make sure you're getting sufficient sleep, which sometimes is a catch 22 because you might have adrenal issues that's preventing you from getting sleep. So we might have to
absolutely
work on that. But so I had low cortisol levels and, you know, so I took B vitamins, I took vitamin C. I also took an herb, which you're familiar with, licorice root, which helps to extend the life of cortisol. And if people want to be cautious, though, because if someone has high blood pressure, that is contraindicated. So, but I think that was helpful. And I took another herb, an adaptogenic herb called Eleuthero, also known as Siberian ginseng. And there's other adaptogenic herbs like ashwagandha, rhodiola. But so those were some of the ones that I took. There's also, in some cases, adrenal glandulars. And, you know, if someone has elevated cortisol, you know, some of the same things. I mean, you could definitely take an adaptogenic herb, but there are other natural supplements to help lower cortisol. And again, they'll assist in lowering cortisol. You still have to do things to manage the stress response and again, do everything else from a diet and lifestyle perspective. But like phosphatidylserine, for example, or Rolora or some of the other supplements. And again, it depends on the findings. If someone does a comprehensive stool panel, and let's say they get tested for H. pylori. So H. pylori in the literature has been shown to be a potential trigger, not always a trigger, but could potentially be a trigger for both Graves and Hashimoto. So if I do see H. pylori, whether it's a comprehensive stool panel or if someone does just a stool antigen test or urea breath test, then I will put them on a protocol or a natural protocol, unless if they choose to take antibiotics. And you know, I'll give one of the supplements I commonly give is NAC, N-acetylcysteine, which supports liver. It helps, it converts into glutathione. And again, so there are some general ones I give, but there are also some that are, you know, based on the testing, such as some of the examples I gave.
Mm-hmm. That's really awesome, actually. I, for those listening, that's a great spectrum and array of supplements and nutrients that can be used. In fact, it reminds me I was mentioning this to you earlier. When I first started out, I was working with somebody, and this particular person had a lot of experience in using supplements. And I remember when I got into the office, people would kind of comment on this person's ability to put supplements together in such a way that would kind of solve most problems. It was actually really impressive. And I came from this world where it was like, you know, predominantly medication, right? Because that's kind of sort of what my training was. I was like, yeah, you know, give him methimazole, give him a beta blocker, right? That'll solve the problem. But this guy was like, you know, intertwining and weaving in the supplements together and having profound results. And I was really impressed by that. So I like the way that you're sort of presenting this information, the various types of supplements that can be used. In fact, I want to talk about several of those. But what I want to do before I do that is kind of ask you, in terms of your approach, and maybe it sounds like I kind of we're on the same page here, but what I found to be true, especially in a lot of thyroid patients, is that if you start with a baseline level of tests and we look at nutrient deficiencies, we look at just through a history, right? We can get an idea as to someone's gut health. We can get ideas to their stress levels, to their sleep. a lot of the times what I'm doing is I'm not saying you have thyroid problems, therefore you need these supplements. Instead, I'm saying, I'm looking at this person and thinking, well, you're not getting enough sleep. You have gut problems. Maybe you have H. pylori. You have these things. So I'm just sort of fixing the obvious problems. And I see the body kind of help respond in kind in that way. So is that kind of a similar kind of approach that you're taking, or is it a little bit different? What's your philosophy on sort of how you come to the conclusion of what therapies and treatments somebody needs?
Yeah, well, I mean, as I mentioned, so some, and not just supplements, but like, for example, diet, with all my patients, I of course focus on diet, and we could talk more about the diet. There's no perfect diet that fits everyone, but to me, there's a starting point for many patients. Mm-hmm. And, again, the stress management, I think, is important, you know, but again, with supplements, as I mentioned, I think there, it's important to, like when I mentioned the fish oils, omega-3s, the vitamin D, the selenium, what all those have in common is that they modulate the immune system. And, you know, in a condition such as Graves' disease, that's very important. But not everybody, you know, many people have a vitamin D deficiency, but usually correct, at least in my experience, correcting a vitamin D deficiency alone usually won't get the person into remission. Same thing with giving the person selenium.
Agreed.
Yeah. So usually I find that we need to dig deeper, and that's where, in my experience, the testing comes into play, whether it's doing adrenal testing, which again, that I commonly recommend, you know, of course, certain blood tests I recommend, sometimes other tests like a comprehensive stool panel, organic acids test. And the testing they get is based on their findings. Just like any practitioner, I do a comprehensive health history and try to figure out, you know, what supplements they may need. And, you know, and then once they're on a certain supplement, then of course we monitor how they're not only, you know, their blood tests primarily, but then sometimes we'll do a follow-up adrenal test. And of course, you know, a lot of people, even without the testing, will notice that they're doing better. And that was me when I was even just taking the bugleweed and the motherwort and not, you know, addressing the cause of the problem at that point. You know, I noticed my symptoms getting better. And that's also the trap. You can't always go by symptoms, because if someone's taking especially antithyroid medication such as methimazole or PTU, that of course is masking the symptoms. So it might cause other symptoms like hyposymptoms. But I think we do take a similar approach. No practitioner takes the exact same approach, but yeah, just really trying to find, remove triggers, trying to address underlying imbalances, nutrient deficiencies, you know, all these things. And, you know, sometimes it's complex. Sometimes it is a smooth process where, you know, someone progresses without any setbacks, but sometimes it is like a roller coaster ride where someone maybe takes a few steps forward, a step back, a few steps forward, a step back. Sometimes a person hits a roadblock and we might, you know, need to do additional testing. So, you know, that, you know, everybody is different. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I appreciate you mentioning that sometimes you go backwards, right? And that actually happens a little bit, you know, two step forward, one step backwards. That's actually pretty common, especially among treating most patients. In fact, the way it was described to me is that, you know, sometimes you feel worse on the right therapies, you know, for a short period of time. And so I've had people who will say that to me, and they'll think that that's a reason to stop doing whatever they're doing, when in reality, it could be the reason, or it could be an indication they need to keep doing it, right? It also could be a sign that maybe they're not on the right thing, but it can't just be automatically a blanket statement, this is wrong because I feel bad for a couple of days, therefore we got to get rid of it. So I appreciate you mentioning that. So what I want to do also is ask you, what kind of effectiveness, how common are you seeing people go into remission if they catch it early? Are there any, you know, signs telltale signs that you can identify in somebody that maybe gives them a higher chance of going to remission? Is this something that you can achieve in, you know, 70, 80, 90% of patients? Is it less? Does it just sort of depend? What kind of effectiveness do you tend to see with these therapies?
I mean, it's pretty effective for those who follow the recommendations. Mm-hmm. You know, I would say, and as you know, again, being a practitioner, just compliance sometimes is a factor. Sure. But I would say about 75%. And nice. And as far as whether predicting if someone is, let's say, a good candidate to go into remission, it honestly does vary. I mean, so if someone has, like, for example, the antibodies associated with Graves' disease, the thyroid stimulating immunoglobulin, TSH receptor antibodies, mm-hmm. you know, and some, I know you can't always go by antibodies, like TPO antibodies, you know, if they're really high, that doesn't always correlate with the, you know, the recovery of the person. The TSI, usually what I've experienced, the higher the level, the higher the immune response, the more likely they are to have thyroid eye disease, which again, we also could chat about if we have time.
Yeah,
So if someone has high TSI, it doesn't, again, I've seen people with elevated TSI, like really high TSI levels, like over 400%, 500%. Mm-hmm. The units do vary. So now changed the units recently. But, you know, and I've seen people where really high levels, they still get into remission. And then on the other hand, I'll see people where, you know, they might have lower antibodies, even mildly high antibodies, and it's more of a struggle. And I think part of that does come with addressing, you know, again, finding, removing triggers. Sometimes it's easy with the person, or I don't want to use the term easy, but sometimes, again, easier in some people. Mm-hmm. Some people, I can't say in most people that diet alone will get the person into remission, but sometimes that is the case. They might just clean up their diet, avoid gluten, and, you know, avoid other common allergens and manage their stress, and might not need to see a practitioner and they get into remission. And then for others, we might do some initial testing and there might be a lot of findings as far as nutrient deficiencies, adrenal imbalances. But even after correcting that, they don't go into remission. So something else is there. And that, you know, so the point is people could have multiple triggers too. And, you know, even if someone has a single trigger, sometimes it could be a challenge to find that trigger. So it really does depend. I can't say I could predict. I mean, I feel confident with most people, but I never know how compliant they're going to be. I will also say that as crazy as it may sound, I think it's easier to get people with Graves into remission than like toxic multinodular goiter. I have success with that as well, but that seems to be a little bit more challenging to get people into remission with that. But with Graves, like I said, it's not easy. It definitely takes time. But yeah, I wish I could say there was, you know, a single pattern, or if someone comes in and their levels, I mean, if someone comes in and the levels are mild, you know, yeah, I like to see that more than someone that has really elevated thyroid hormone levels and, you know, sky high TSI, but it's not always easier to treat the one with the mild case. I will say, most of my patients are adults, but I deal with some, unfortunately, some children, teenagers with hyperthyroidism. Mm-hmm. And sometimes in them, it could be a quicker process, but it's a little bit of a catch 22 because also when they're that young, it's also could be more challenging to be compliant,
right?
Especially like with the diet. So, like I said, I wish I could say that there was like a single pattern where I could look and say, yeah, you have a 90-95% chance of getting into remission, where someone else comes and sees me and they might only have a 50% chance of getting into remission. But I can't say I consistently, you know, see a single pattern like that.
Yeah, no, I appreciate the honesty there. And I think that's maybe one of the reasons that conventional doctors don't quite really understand functional medicine, because the way that we're talking about this is highly individualized. Every person's a little different. You know, the supplements they need are going to be different. Their triggers might be different. And so when you look at conventional medicine, they want to look at things in the aggregate. So if you give somebody a beta blocker, they want to see it work 95% of the time, right? And that's just not going to be the case with some of these supplements. Like someone may not need it, right? Not everyone necessarily needs, you know, I don't know, let's just say fish oil, for example, or vitamin D, if their level's okay and they're out in the sun all the time, right? There are situations in which you can't universally apply these recommendations broadly across the population of anyone who has just this single disease state. And so I think maybe that's why a lot of people struggle, or at least conventional doctors struggle with this idea that we're kind of talking about. But as a patient, it makes perfect sense, right? You want somebody that's going to treat you individually, unique, in a unique way. You want supplements catered to your situation, to your condition. You want somebody to be searching for the triggers. And that actually leads me to the next question, which I want to mention is what type of triggers are you seeing as the most common cause of, let's talk about Graves' disease. And if you want to throw in anything else there, like toxic multinodular goiter, you can as well. But what kind of main triggers are you seeing for Graves' disease?
Yeah, so with Graves, I mean, stress, without question, and everybody deals with stress, and there's different types of stressors too. But I know, again, my adrenals were a big factor with my Graves' disease condition. And it's not just emotional stress. I think one thing that's important to mention, prior to diagnosis, I was also overtraining, and that could put a lot of stress on adrenals.
You mean exercising, overtraining?
Overexercising, yeah.
Yeah.
So So yeah, adrenals, you know, stress, adrenals, that causes dysregulation of the immune system. And, you know, again, is it always the direct trigger, or is it sometimes just like the, you know, the straw that broke the camel's back?
Right.
You know, that definitely could be the case, but either way you want to, you know, address stress. You know, I mentioned food. Food is not, I don't see it as a primary trigger. Again, I would say stress is definitely up there, but that being said, it could be a trigger. And then certain foods such as gluten, dairy, corn could be inflammatory. Mm-hmm. So I think if someone continues to eat those foods, it's going to be difficult to heal. So I do have people avoid those foods. And gut infections, again, just like things like H. pylori, you know, just, you know, is common. You know, parasites, there's nothing in the literature showing like, I haven't seen anything in the literature, like correlation between Graves and parasites. There is a case study on Hashimoto's and blastocystis hominis that knows out there, but I have seen where, you know, I've done a comprehensive stool panel and there's been, you know, the patient has parasites, you know, we clean them out, they get into remission. You know, of course, again, there's also situations where we see a parasite and again, we get rid of the parasite and they don't get into remission. I'm like, okay, sure. Something else out there. And then, you know, there's also flaws with the testing too, because sometimes a person might have a parasite, but it doesn't show up on a comprehensive stool panel.
Right.
So yeah, the testing unfortunately is not perfect. But so again, stress, gut infections. Again, I'm going to include food in there, even though I would say it's not like the primary thing I see. You know, toxins, it's hard to really measure. The thing is also I have, you know, most people, pretty much everybody, and even myself, since being in remission, I've been just always working on reducing my toxic load. And, you know,
it's always a good thing.
Yeah, exactly. We live in a very toxic world. And so with some patients, it might be basic. I mentioned like the NAC, N-acetylcysteine. Sometimes you might, you know, have them take liposomal glutathione or methylated glutathione. We might talk about sauna, you know, infrared sauna. To help sweat out the toxins.
Right.
So again, that could be a factor as well. And with toxic multinodular goiter, the two more common triggers, and this is also in the research, so problems with estrogen metabolism, as well as insulin resistance being two big potential factors with toxic multinodular goiter. So those are, you know, two things that I usually address or look into. There is testing, obviously, with insulin resistance. You can do testing with estrogen metabolism. It's not as easy. There is, you know, you're probably familiar with dried urine testing, Dutch testing.
The Dutch, yeah.
Estrogen metabolites.
Right. But
those are, you know, seem to be more of a factor with, you know, toxic multinodular goiter. And even, I mean, with Graves, those could be factors too. Again, I don't know if you would say they're always direct triggers. If someone has insulin resistance, or, you know, you also talk about leptin resistance. I mean, those, you know, again, could be a factor, but are they the primary factor, or the triggers? I mean, sometimes it is difficult to differentiate, like what's a trigger, what's a contributing factor. But like most natural healthcare practitioners, we try to correct everything. So if we see three or four different imbalances, and, you know, maybe a few of them are, maybe only one's a trigger, but again, we don't know. So we just just try to correct everything we see, try to get the person in an optimal state of health.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. I think it's really hard to ever say this thing is primary, this thing is secondary, this thing is tertiary. You know, it's really hard to pinpoint one of those things. But like you said, if it's there, you treat it. Now, in a lot of cases, you can sometimes correct something and then downstream you'll see improvement in these things and they kind of clean themselves up. And so I'll sort of pull back the punches in terms of therapy sometimes if I think, you know, treating this will treat, you know, symptom 4 and 5, right? So you see a lot of that sometimes as well. The other thing I was going to ask you is, what about Epstein-Barr virus? So there's some connection between these two conditions, especially Hashimoto's. I don't know about Graves' disease, so kind of get your opinion on that. Do you see Epstein-Barr virus as a potential cause, trigger, or is it one of those things that maybe it's just secondary, it happens to be there, maybe it's causing a little inflammation, and if you treat it, you see a little improvement? What are your thoughts on Epstein-Barr and Graves?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked the question, because I do test for Epstein-Barr.
Yeah.
I test for, you know, the IgM, but then the three IgG markers as well. And, you know, I still think we don't understand everything about viruses. Maybe with everything that's happened over the past, you know, year and a half or so, we'll, you know, do even more research on other viruses such as Epstein-Barr. But the literature shows that there is a correlation. Again, correlation doesn't always mean causation, but that Epstein-Barr could be potentially be a trigger with both Graves and Hashimoto's. And when, you know, when I see, I don't see a lot of IgM elevated with Epstein-Barr, but if I do, then of course I'm going to get concerned. But even if I see really high, extremely high IgG markers, you know, there's now, you know, just some practitioners, you know, are suspecting that that may mean that the Epstein-Barr virus is reactivated. And I will say, though, that even if it is a potential trigger, most people have Epstein-Barr.
Right.
So I can't say I go crazy with the antiviral protocols. There's sometimes I will put someone on an antiviral, like put them on antiviral herbs. I even, you know, more recently over the last few years, have used some homeopathy. Mm-hmm. But it, to me, it's more of an immune system problem.
Right.
So what I try to do is try to see what's dragging down the person's immune system and then correct those imbalances. If someone, again, has is dealing with a lot of stress and their adrenals are compromised, and if they have issues with the gut, you know, most of the immune system cells are in the gut, so you need healthy gut for healthy immune system. So
right.
You know, if we're not addressing those, but if all we're doing is putting someone on a protocol for Epstein-Barr or, you know, any other type of virus, like cytomegalovirus is another one. If someone gets on a protocol, but if we're not doing anything to improve the immune system health, then it's really not going to be effective. And what I see is sometimes by addressing these other areas, the person doesn't need to be on an antiviral protocol. Mm-hmm. Some people do. And sometimes I'll put a person on an antiviral protocol. My perception also changed because in 2018, I was diagnosed with chronic Lyme disease. And, you know, and again, I realized, even though I did treat the infection, I took herbs, I took homeopathy, I actually did some IV ozone therapy too. I was a little bit aggressive with that just because I was concerned about being debilitated. And
sure, yeah.
You know, but I realized also that's more, you know, it's not exactly the same as Epstein-Barr, but still it's important to have a healthy immune system when it comes to these stealth infections, whether it's viruses, whether it's, you know, Lyme disease, whether it's Bartonella. So my number one approach is to improve immune system health. But there are times when I will directly treat the infection.
Yeah. And I think the focus on immune system makes a lot of sense. So and just for clarification for those listening, when Dr. Osansky was talking about IgM antibodies and IgG antibodies, the IgM indicates like a more recent infection, in fact, an acute infection, and the IgG simply means that you had it at some point. It could have been a year ago, it could have been 6 months ago, it could have been 20 years ago. You don't really know. And so you get put in this weird situation if you're a provider and you're checking for Epstein-Barr virus via the IgG antibodies. You know, 70%, 80% of people are going to come up positive. So then what do you do? Do you look at it and you think, well, I guess I'm going to treat everybody? And it sounds like Dr. Osansky, what you're saying here is, no, it just sort of depends on the situation. And that's really kind of what I found. Although I can tell you from experience that there have been a handful of times when I try and do everything I can, they're not seeing improvement. I'm like, well, I mean, we got these Epstein-Barr virus that we can look at, we treat it, and you see amazing improvement. And so it's like in some people, it's there, and it's a huge potential source where you can of treatment where somebody can feel a lot better if you do it. The hard part is figuring out who is who. You know, it could be 1 out of 100, or I don't know, 1 in 1,000. Who knows? But it's not as easy to figure out who is going to benefit from that treatment. And so that's why I said I think this focus on the immune system makes the most sense, because, you know, if you focus on the immune system, help your body get rid of it on its own, or at least suppress it back, prevent the flare-ups or recurrent infections, or you know, the chronic smoldering type of infection that can exist, then that probably puts you in the best situation. But if you're somebody listening to this, you have Graves or Hashimoto's, and maybe you've tried everything and it hasn't worked, well, it's worth looking into. You know, a lot of these therapies aren't necessarily let's say damaging or harmful, if you're going to look at these antiviral therapies, at least in my experience. So, I appreciate that. Did you have any other thoughts to add on to that topic before we move on? Or
no, I agree. It sounds like you take a similar approach. If someone's not responding and those antibodies are sky high, you know, the IgG, I know we're not going to get rid of them. And I make sure tell the patient they're never going to normalize. But yeah, I've seen where the markers dramatically decrease, you know, so we take the same approach, I think. Focus on immune system first, but if someone's not improving, I have no problems putting them on an antiviral protocol. And yes, that's sometimes what I do.
Okay, good. And so, yeah, we're definitely on the same page there. Let's transition a little bit to diet, because we talked about this briefly. There are some things, what you said previously, if I'm going back into your conversation, you mentioned that there are some principles and tenets that, especially as it comes to diet and, you know, maybe even certain supplements, that most people tend to improve on if they have, you know, hyperthyroidism or Graves' disease. So let's talk a little bit about diet. What are those sort of, you know, the foundational blocks of dietary foods or that they may eat or may restrict that can improve that situation or outcome? And then we'll kind of build on top of that from there. So kind of when you look at diet and you look at somebody with Graves, what are you starting with? Let's put it that way.
So I think most practitioners would agree that you want to have the person eat whole healthy foods and try to avoid the inflammatory foods. So whole healthy foods, you know, what I consider a whole healthy food. So eating a good amount of vegetables and variety of vegetables, you know, some fruit usually is okay. If someone eats meat and they're not a vegan vegetarian, then eating healthier forms of meat like grass-fed beef, pasture-raised chicken, for example.
Right.
And then avoiding certain foods, like I mentioned earlier, gluten, dairy, corn. Some will say to avoid all grains. And I honestly take that approach where I tell not to say that people, there are some people that have that struggle with giving up grains completely, and that could go with any food. And there are some people that still will eat a small amount of grains and they might do okay. But usually I tell the person to avoid grains while healing. Inflammatory, like unhealthy oils, like canola oil, for example, try to have them stick with like avocado oil, coconut oil, olive oil, of course. And, you know, of course, avoiding fast food. And a big reason is because of those unhealthy oils. And of course, the poor quality, just in general, the food, the refined foods and sugars. And, you know, there's some research also with salt. So I do recommend some natural sea salt, but I did want to mention that, you know, too much salt is associated with high blood pressure. At least that's what we think, you know, we have too much salt, that's going to raise blood pressure.
But there
is some evidence that too much sodium chloride can increase Th17 cells, which are associated with autoimmunity. So you also want to be careful about eating too much salt. And again, if you're eating not just salt in your food, but just eating a lot of packaged foods, because a lot of packaged foods will have, pretty much all packaged foods will have sodium. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so I will say, as far as different diets, though, I did mention earlier, there's no diet that fits everyone perfectly.
Right.
But I do tend to have my, at least my Graves' disease patients start on autoimmune paleo or
AIP.
Yeah, if that's too strict, paleo, you know, so AIP, as I'm sure you know, that is more strict than paleo in that it, you're avoiding eggs, you're avoiding nightshades, you're avoiding nuts and seeds. And, you know, there are some people that do fine on paleo. They might find AIP too restrictive, and you know, it's kind of compromising. They're like, I could do paleo, but I can't do AIP. And some people do okay. There are some people where they hit a roadblock and they will, you know, do AIP. And as I mentioned earlier, you know, food isn't the only factor. So we also do get people who are following AIP and maybe they feel a little bit better, but they're not feeling that much better. You know, I still tell them, don't get discouraged, because it's never going to hurt to avoid the inflammatory foods. And if you're eating certain foods, again, maybe the eggs, if you didn't introduce, maybe you gave up eggs for no reason. Like, you know, if you followed AIP, maybe you didn't have to give up the eggs, but we didn't know. And so you gave them up. There are some people that, you know, they'll continue eating the eggs. And then until they take a break from the eggs, they won't notice an improvement. So to me, I don't want someone to be super restrictive, but it's again, another one of those catch-22s where if someone is not restrictive enough, they might hit a roadblock, and I'm not sure if it's the food. And to me, that's the easiest place to start. Again, not easy, it's a challenge. And I went through it too when I was dealing with Graves' disease, but you know, it's definitely less expensive than having someone spend hundreds or thousands of dollars on additional testing. You know, rather than say, well, why don't we just, you know, try to avoid these foods that could be factors, and, you know, do it at least for 30 days. If you could do it for a few months, that's even better. And, you know, but if someone compromises and they want to do paleo, or they might even want to do modified paleo, where they're like, well, you know, can I have a little bit of rice per day? Mm-hmm. And, you know, again, it's ultimately up to the patients, you know, no matter what I say, it's going to be up to them. And, you know, if they continue doing that, and, or if they drink coffee, I would usually recommend avoiding coffee, but if they could do everything else, but have a little bit of coffee, sometimes it might affect adrenals and prevent them from healing, you know, with the caffeine and all that, but sometimes it might not. So sometimes there is some negotiation, but I think the commonality is, again, whole healthy foods, plenty of vegetables, try to eat organic whenever possible. Again, some sea salt's okay, but not a lot of salt in general. Avoid the unhealthy oils. And those are some of the recommendations I give.
Yeah, I honestly agree with almost every one of those, to be honest. In fact, I don't think there's anything I don't agree with. I will say that in my experience, just treating mostly Hashimoto's, right? I didn't treat a ton of Graves, but mostly treated Hashimoto's. By the time people got to me with Graves, it was post-thyroidectomy and post-radioactive iodine ablation. So it was a little bit different of story. But I would use AIP, but I tend to reserve AIP just because, like you said, it's a little bit stricter. It's harder to follow, maybe some compliance issues and so on. I usually reserve it for somebody who has multiple autoimmune conditions or really severe conditions. Like, and that was just my personal preference. You know, for anyone listening to this, you don't necessarily have to follow that. That's just sort of how I thought about it. And so if somebody came in, let's say with like vitiligo and celiac disease and Hashimoto's, well, now we've got three autoimmune diseases on one. I'm like, this person is, you know, for lack of a better term, a mess with their immune system. Right. And so this person needs, you know, probably a little more aggressive therapies. And so that's when I would pull out the big gun, so to speak. I did want to ask you, what do you think about carnivore? What do you think about keto? Do these have any place in the treatment of Graves' disease or other hyperthyroid conditions? Or are these things that you've used in the past with variable success? Or kind of how do you think about those two diets?
Yeah, I can't say I've used a lot of, again, I'm familiar with both ketogenic and carnivore diet. There's
definitely
overlap with the two.
Right.
And I mean, I will say that, you know, with AIP, I am, you know, low carb, not quite as low as ketogenic. And then I do encourage people to eat healthy fats. But yeah, I mean, if someone is eating a healthy ketogenic diet, and I don't know if there's really research on carnivore diet, but I know that there's been a number of people just, just doing some searching and just maybe even like seeing in like my Facebook group, like people posting that they follow carnivore diet and, you know, and that really helped with their autoimmunity and reducing inflammation. You know, of course, if they're doing that, I'm sure they're eating whole, like healthier forms.
Right.
But yeah, that's what I was saying. There's no perfect diet that fits everyone. And ketogenic, you know, if someone especially is struggling with losing weight, sometimes that could be a factor. Sometimes, as you know, that there could be other factors and ketogenic doesn't help. But I think, again, the commonality, whole healthy food. So I think ketogenic could potentially work. I think, carnivore could work. I mentioned even paleo, you know, could work. It's not just AIP. And sometimes there's modified. If someone's a vegan vegetarian, sometimes I'll have them follow, I don't know if you're familiar with Dr. Gundry and his plant paradox diet.
The lectin.
Where he has like modifications where he allows certain nuts and he actually allows legumes, which is not allowed on either AIP or paleo, but as long as they're properly prepared or pressure cooked. And so with a vegan vegetarian, it's even more difficult for them to follow AIP or even paleo. So, so again, I see people respond okay, you know, with that type of modified diet. So yeah, I think, again, as long as you're, I think the big thing, avoiding the inflammatory foods, the challenge is sometimes healthier foods, like again, eggs is a good example. I think eggs are great, even though there's always controversies. If you look certain places, read certain books, some will say not to eat eggs with our conditions. But I think some people do perfectly fine with eggs, but some people don't. And same thing with nightshades, like tomatoes, eggplant, potatoes, or white potatoes, or peppers. So again, some people won't do well with nightshades. Other people, it's not a problem. So that's why I tend to be a little bit more restrictive. But again, you could go either way. Someone could just do paleo, or again, they could do ketogenic, carnivore, you know, just pick a healthier diet as a starting point, and then you could always make modifications.
Yeah, you know, you're right. You could start with the strict, you know, removal of all these things that have potentially caused problems and add to it over time, or you could start with the broader and taper down as you go. So I don't think there's necessarily a right or a wrong. I just sort of think it depends. So the takeaway here, if you're listening to this, is that diet is highly individualized and it's very unique. It's up to the person. And this sort of brings me into my next quick topic. And this will probably be the last one that we talk about just because we're running a little short on time here, and that has to do with weight gain. So in hyperthyroid patients can actually paradoxically experience weight gain, right? And it can be confusing for a lot of hyperthyroid patients. And in your case, remember when you talked about it, of course you remember it was your case, but you lost a lot of weight in the beginning, right? And however, there are a lot of people taking methimazole, especially these anti-thyroid medications. I don't think people use PTU quite as much anymore, but mostly methimazole or some other anti-thyroid medication, and they experience weight gain. So can you talk just sort of why that is, that some hyperthyroid patients may experience this weight gain? And then maybe we'll talk a little bit about the therapies and what to do in those type of situations and kind of how you think about that.
Yeah, definitely. So as you mentioned, anti-thyroid medication is one factor. So someone might not have been gaining weight until they started taking, let's say, the methimazole. And you're right, PTU, not as common every now and then, especially if someone can't take methimazole, they might be taking PTR if someone is pregnant.
Trimester.
But yeah, either way, whatever type of anti-thyroid medication, that could cause problems with weight gain. And it, we see it more commonly with higher doses, but even if someone's on like 5 milligrams of methimazole, that could happen. So that could be a challenge. Inflammation, just, I mean, there are a number of different factors, but inflammation alone can make it difficult to lose weight. And these conditions, Graves, Hashimoto's, other autoimmune conditions are quite inflammatory. And that's another reason why you want to do as much as you can through diet and supplementation to try to bring down the inflammation. And high cortisol, so I mentioned low cortisol in my case, but high cortisol can make it difficult to lose weight. So supporting the adrenals, it could be very important. And insulin resistance, and I know you talk a lot about leptin resistance, you know, so those also could be factors when it comes to weight gain. And again, we could talk more about that. You're the expert on when it comes to leptin resistance, but let's see, estrogen, problems with estrogen metabolism also, that could be a factor. Even increased toxic, like having increased toxic load, you know, could be a factor as well. But I would say more commonly, like probably when it comes to, you know, just people dealing with hyperthyroidism who have the weight gain, all these could be factors. I would say, you know, the anti-thyroid medication, I would say the inflammation, and again, problems with the cortisol, because again, I mentioned how, you know, stress is a big factor. And even though I had low cortisol, a lot of people have high cortisol.
They do.
So yeah, in my experience, those are some of the more common causes of weight gain for those who experience weight gain with hyperthyroidism.
And I think we probably have seen a little bit of a different patient population in a way. And because a lot of people are coming to me and they're just on methimazole, but probably most of them, I don't think, have gone really deep into the supplements we're talking about, touching on the omega-3 to omega-6 fatty acid ratio, reducing inflammation, fixing gut health, doing their dietary changes and things like that. But if you're doing all that stuff, there's a good chance that you could come off of methimazole, right? That would be the entire goal. And if I think about methimazole, if you're a patient listening to this, it's really putting the brake on your entire metabolism. Like that's really what it's doing. And the degree to which it breaks your metabolism is dependent upon the dose that you're taking. So if you're taking, like, you know, Dr. Osansky said, a high dose, I mean, good luck trying to lose weight while you're, it's like, you know, pressing the gas while you're trying to press and the brake simultaneously. It's just, you're not moving forward. You're going to stand still. And so your number one goal, in my opinion, should be to see somebody like Dr. Osansky if you're trying to lose weight, because if you can get off the methimazole, if you can fix those underlying problems, the estrogen, metabolism, cortisol, insulin, leptin, you know, et cetera, if you can fix those problems, then you're going to actually be able to lose weight. But trying to lose weight while taking methimazole, I think is, you know, a losing battle. You know, I just don't see a lot of success there. So, and I think I think we're on the same page with that. I guess one last question here I want to ask, because I know we're running out of time here, but what do you think about fasting in the setting of hyperthyroidism? Is this a therapy that you use a lot? Do you have a lot of success with it? What do you think about it in general for hyperthyroid patients?
Yeah, so I will say I'm definitely an advocate of fasting. I do intermittent fasting.
Yeah.
But when it comes to hyperthyroidism, you know, I would say it depends on the person. More times, you usually know. I mean, there's if someone, you know, definitely not in a case like mine where someone's losing a lot of weight, but it's not just the weight, it's also the adrenals. You know, a lot of people just have compromised adrenals. And so what I try to do is just try to, you know, improve their adrenal health. And to me, and everybody's going to have a different opinion, but to me, fasting is more something we'll do when they're in a better state of health. Again, there are exceptions. Like if someone's dealing with insulin resistance, you know, or leptin resistance, then, you know, maybe, you know, doing intermittent fasting, you know, and I'm sure it would help, but it's one of those things. If someone has, you know, really compromised adrenals, you know, are there other ways to do it without the intermittent fasting? So yeah, I personally don't recommend intermittent fasting. Usually, again, there's always exceptions.
Sure.
But most of the time, I don't go that route. But like I said, I'm definitely a believer. I do a lot of intermittent fasting myself.
That's good to know. And I'm actually really grateful we had this conversation, because you've given me a lot more information, I'm embarrassed to say, than I knew previously. So thank you for that. Thank you for sharing your knowledge. And I would strongly recommend, if you're somebody in that situation where you're taking methimazole or an anti-thyroid medication and you're trying to prevent thyroidectomy, which is surgical removal of the thyroid, or radioactive iodine ablation, which again, these are, you know, for the most part, RAI can be somewhat permanent, but these are permanent, we'll say treatments to a problem that doesn't necessarily have to occur in all situations. And my recommendation, my parting words of advice would be to avoid those conditions or to avoid those therapies at all costs, if at all possible. And so seeing somebody like Dr. Osansky, I think is the way to go with that. And I really mean it. If you don't believe me, go check out the comment section on any video that I do regarding thyroidectomy or radioactive iodine ablation. You will see a ton of people who will regret getting that condition done. So, talk to them, look at them, because it's permanent. Once it's out, it's out. And your body, no matter how good you think doctors are, they're never going to be as good as your own thyroid gland at producing thyroid hormone. You know, this is something that's working constantly every single day. And, you know, the doctor at the end of the day, once they pull it out, or surgically cut it out, or destroy it with radiation, they'll give you one thyroid medication once per day, right? That does not take the place of the function of the thyroid gland. So that's my parting words of advice for you. But I do want to let you, Dr. Osansky, tell people how to reach you if they want to get in contact with you. Maybe if they want to read more about your books or get your books, or maybe do some coaching with you if that's what you're doing now. So maybe kind of tell people where they can find you.
Sure. So my website is naturalendocrinesolutions.com. So I have a lot of articles, hundreds of different articles, many of them on hyperthyroidism, some on hypothyroidism, Hashimoto's, and then my book as well, Natural Treatment Solutions for Hyperthyroidism and Graves' Disease, you could find on Amazon. And then also I just have a new podcast, Save My Thyroid podcast.
Oh, good.
So all that, find that where most podcasts are found.
Yeah. Give me the link to that. I'll include that below.
Yeah. Or actually you could save my thyroid podcast.com.
Okay.
So that's, and yeah, so those are some of the places where people could find me.
Awesome. Well, Dr. Osansky, I really appreciate your time. And if people have any questions after wherever you're watching this, go ahead and leave those comments below. I'll do my best to answer those. And if Dr. Osansky maybe has time, he can peek by as well. But that's all I have for you guys. And otherwise, I will see you in the next one.